extremes of cold. We can do mountains and valleys, and we can do good jobs and crazy jobs. We can do sane and insane relationships.
All right.
Well, y'all know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah.
When you wake up in the morning and you look over there and you say,
my Lord.
What was I thinking?
Yes.
And what can I do to change this, get this person out of my situation? Anybody understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
What in the world? Because none of you have had that. Okay, I have had those experiences, right? National Geographic has a show that's called Life Below Zero. And it's about people who choose to live in environments near the Arctic Circle where the temperature is never above zero. On many days, 20 to 40 degrees below zero. A human being has to do all sorts of things to acclimate to the harsh ice desert where one is in constant danger of frostbite, starvation, and becoming some other animal's protein. Polar bear, Arctic wolf, the caribou, the Siberian husky, they don't need parkas and muckluck boots and face guards because they are in a habitat that they are acclimated to. Mm. So the question is, brothers and sisters, how do we seek to find our place in a world where we do not have to put so much of our energy into adjusting to environments that are not designed for us? And we do, when we get out of rooms like this, come on, help me. On our jobs, in our families, in our faith-based organizations, it's about adjusting. It's about being in environments that seek to diminish our capacity.
Come on.
When Jesus went to Nazareth on a visit to his home synagogue, people asked the question because he'd been gone a while and his reputation was following him. They said, well, we heard about his good works. This is paraphrased. But the question is, who is this guy? Isn't this Joseph's son and Mary's boy? Isn't this the brother? And he named his four brothers, and then they said, and his sisters, which, by the way, didn't get any names. But nonetheless, when they identified with him, they said, what is all this hype about Jesus? And then the text says, and he could not do great works, listen to me, among them because they did not believe. And he said, a prophet is without honor in his own home. I'm talking to a room full of prophets,
yes. Right.
Who are in environments that do not know who you are. And we content ourselves often to be in those environments because we have acclimated ourselves to environments that diminish our capacity.
Yeah.
Well, I'm talking good. And if they will just let us be on the usher board, and if they will just let us continue to hold up the tenor in the choir, anybody understand
that? Yeah.
And if they will just allow us to plan the Christmas program and the Easter parade,
okay,
or be the group of men that keep the First Lady looking fabulous,
okay.
If they will, then they will never find out that we are poets. Come on with me.
Yes.
And that we are seers and prophets. They will never know the real deep spirituality that has always been associated with this small percentage of the population. We are the people out of which have come the greatest prophets of all time.
That's right. That's right.
The greatest griots, the greatest shaman of every time and generation have been born out of this community.
That's right.
Oh, I know what I'm talking about.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do.
Yet we repress that reality. And we repress that reality often because of our need to acclimate. And the way that it moves is when we get angry enough and we tell the people, I'm out, kiss my entire posterior anatomy. Then we will not go to faith-based organizations that affirm us.
Come on.
I'm still talking.
Come on.
Because it feels that those places are less authentic.
Come on.
And the house of the oppressor. Essentially, without the pageantry. And the beauty and the church choir marching in. Anybody understand? And the big church hat. And the front row and the pageantry. Y'all know what I'm talking about. All of the things that are associated with when you got a 500 voice choir. We will not create for ourselves safe places for spirituality to grow because we do not believe in our own spiritual authenticity. Now, tell you like the saints say, you may not invite me back. But while I'm here. So here's our challenge. With as much power as exists in this room, and as many of our sisters and brothers who are on the periphery, who are finding spirituality in the club, who are creating spiritual opportunities in the house and ball culture, sisters and brothers who are languishing for lack of community on the edge, who need something like this, not just occasionally,
that's right,
but something that they can hook into on a regular and consistent basis. You see, you need me. And I need you. Because we're all a part of God's body.
Come on now.
Stand with me. Agree with me. Because we're all a part of God's body. It is God's will that every need be supplied.
Yes.
You are important to me.
Come on.
And I need you to survive. So let me tell you just a little bit more and I'm going to stop. How then do we seek and find our place in a world where we put so much of our energy into adjusting to environments that are not designed for us? A preacher friend of mine came to me the other day and said, I've been pastoring YvetteFlunder for 30 years. 15 of those years I've been miserable. Because the more I discovered who I really am, the less comfortable I felt. 15 of those years, big tall man cried, had been weighed down to cry on my shoulder. But he came all the way down and he wept and he cried. And I started to speak out of my ego and say to him, well, why don't you leave? Get up and go. But I've lived long enough to know that get up and go is not easy for everyone.
Yeah.
Get up and go. Get up and go when your mama's still there. Come on now. Get up and go when you have social connections. And I didn't know about his life. I said, perhaps he needs to stay because that's the only way he can see himself making money. I told you I've been in gospel music for a long time, right? And I have colleagues that I have known that they are gay people, lesbian people. I have known it all of my life. We talk. We have clandestine conversations. What is amazing to me is you know them too.
Oh, yeah.
It would be no gospel music without gay people.
Hello.
Maybe three songs. Maybe two. Maybe three songs. The conundrum is, you have a gay choir director, you've got most of the tenors, half of the altos, sampling of the sopranos, you've got the person that's on the piano, perhaps not the drums, unless it's a woman, but a person who's on the piano, I'm not doing this. You're the choir director, and the preacher gets up and preaches the gay people in the hell, and the choir shouts.
Right.
What's
wrong with that?
Something's wrong with that picture. Something has happened and something is wrong.
Come on, Bishop.
With that picture. What is the shout about?
Come on.
Come on now.
And they're singing a song a gay person wrote.
Come on. the bus. Why is that all right?
It's not all right, bitch. Mm-hmm. It's not all right.
And where is our voice against it?
Come on.
Why can't the Church of God in Christ take this pregnant moment and use it to re-examine its own response to human sexuality? Why couldn't the National Baptist Convention say that if Flunder is coming, let's take a look at where we have stood historically about sexuality and perhaps get together with other leaders of organizations and see if we can write a new ethic, a new edict that not only is inclusive of same gender loving people, but our straight young people also don't know what to do. Because they know they can't do what grandma and them told them to do, and they're not doing it. Some of you are parents.
Come on.
Godparents and parents.
Yes.
And you have young adults. And you don't know what to tell them. No, don't, well, don't do, well, protect yourself. Let's carry something with you. I will can't go to the Bible because I know that doesn't make any sense. And you're not, so anyway, keep something in your pocket. God bless you. See you when you get back. Listen, there is some kind of message to deliver that's going to require people who are spiritual meeting together and writing a new, perhaps a new epistle.
Go ahead.
Perhaps it's time for a third testament.
Well.
Perhaps we need to gather some writing that includes some of the things we have written. Because we've written some holy things. Perhaps. So here's the real question. I wanted to ask that man when he said what he said to me, what makes your heart sing? Look at somebody and say, what makes your heart sing?
What makes your heart sing?
What are you doing when you say, now this is what I'm talking about. What are you involved in? What is the joy of your life? What do you feel genuinely called to do and be? It doesn't mean that we don't work hard at what makes our hearts sing, but being tired from a productive and beautiful life is very different from being tired from wasting yourself in atmospheres that don't appreciate your gifts. I imagine that some of you all may expect for me to have a concrete answer to this life-impacting, life-changing question of how do we acclimate ourselves in all of these atmospheres that diminish our capacity. But let me say something to you. I don't have a specific answer for you. But I had to find a specific answer for myself. It began with my having integrity in my spiritual life. Essentially, it became very clear to me that what I needed to do was to make the sacrifices that my integrity called for. And that was an easy thing to do in the Church of God in Christ. Because I came out in the Pentecostal church. I didn't leave the Pentecostal church to come out. I came out in the Pentecostal church. And I wasn't alone as a same gender loving person. We had a very robust underground. Everything I know how to do, I learned it in church.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Church people, anybody understand me? Yes. Oh, as the saints were saying, oh, they taught me well.
Yes.
Anybody understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Learned it right there in the church, and back in the church. Speaking in tongues and everything. Right there in the church.
Come on now.
How do we then maintain our integrity? I believe that what is key for me, was doing the pioneering work. And so I want to say to the organizers of this event, pioneering work is not easy work. Because we have to undo the ravages of the colonizer. And our spirits are colonized. If I had time, I would spend some time with this with you today, but I don't, we'll do it later. Our spirits are colonized. We learned most of our faith paths in the context of oppression. We learned Christianity. Those of us that still practice or do practice Christianity learned it in the context of chattel slavery. That's the way our forebears learned it. And it was a catechism. It was a Christianity catechism that said that if you are truly going to please God, you have to submit to your masters. And you also have to be willing to tell on the folks who are planning revolt or planning to run off the plantation. Those are things that God requires. You also, we were taught that even in heaven, there will be two classes, the servant class and the served class. Essentially, eternal life would not free us from our God-given responsibility to be the servant class. That's the context in which we learned Christianity. And then we found ourselves, when we grab hold to it real good, needing to create our own servant class. And for a period of time, that was women. And in some places, it still is. Somebody hit me.
Come on down.
That's all fucking
yes, true.
And then as the women began to step up, then we created another servant class. The servant class essentially became same gender loving men in particular.
All right.
Who were available for sex that didn't procreate. I'm talking good now.
Yes.
My mother said it was all about holes and poles. Can I tell the truth? And this servant class, because it was necessary always for someone to stay in power, there has to be a servant class.
Come on.
So a preacher came to me at the National Baptist Convention in the morning when I was having my breakfast, and he said to me, he said, Bishop Flunder, this was at 6:30 in the morning. He said, let me tell you something. Just me and you talking. He said, I've always liked boys. I said, okay. He said, I've always liked boys. He said, and he said, what I'm talking to you about is that I feel bad about something. I said, what do you feel bad about? He said, because I preach hard against homosexuality. I said, so reconcile that for me. You've always liked boys. Do you like boys? Like them from a distance? Or you like boys? Do you understand what I'm saying? You have sex with boys, young men. He said, well, yes, I do. He said, but I'm not gay gay. I said, so break that down for me. You're not gay gay. You're just gay. You're not gay gay. What's gay gay as a relationship? In relationship to gay. He said, well, you know, I like more feminine men. I said, so you're a top. Well, yeah. He said, well, yeah. He said, because I see him, it's kind of like being with women. I said, so someone as long as holes and poles. Anybody understand me?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
The person is subservient to you in some way. It makes you feel you're not gay gay. Well, yeah, kind of like that. He said, but you know, I found out here late that I have to use drugs and substances to really enjoy sex. How am I doing with this? Is this too rich?
No, it's not.
I'm just trying to see. I'm just trying to see what I'm doing. I said, so tell me how you got to use some, what you're using.
Yes.
He said, well, I'm starting using Tina. I said, you're using Tina. I said, so you're a big time, you would know him if I called his name, big time Baptist preacher.
Right.
Using Tina.
Come on.
With young men.
He's a preacher,
but you're not gay gay.
School of mission.
And I said, so are there many like you?
Whole
burn. He said, oh, it's a whole burn. And you're preaching against, yes, actively, he said, and I feel badly about it. I said, so I'm not mother confessor.
Come on now.
What do you want me? me to do. He said, well, I felt like I had to tell somebody. I said, so I want you to be clear. You didn't get liberated.
That's right.
Yes.
Because you told me.
Come on now.
He said to me, so then what do you think I need to do? Said, what do you think you need to do? And he said, well, I can't, this is his next comment to me, I can't come out to my people. He said, it will destroy my ministry.
Oh.
And I said to him, I said, baby, let me tell you something. Your people already know who you are.
Yes.
Come on now.
They're just acclimating themselves. They have you figured out. And when you do what you do, how you do what you do, who you do what you do with, then that gives them license to do what they do. Because I know these boys, as you said, they're not keeping sweet water on their stomach, honey. They're telling everything to everybody that they want to tell it to in their own circles. Come on with me. And their own networks. So you are the one deceived into thinking that you are hidden. You're not hidden. As far as they're concerned, you are gay. Gay. Everybody understand? He said, well, my ministry will be destroyed. I said, let me tell you how it's going to go. Somebody's going to tell it. They're going to edit on you. They're going to tell it.
Okay.
And when they tell it, I said, the next thing that you'll find is that Tina's going to win. You can't win over Tina.
Yeah.
Tina is going to win over you. Because you are not concerned about the wholeness and health of your own life.
That's it.
He said, well then, I don't know what to do. I said, sure you do. You pick a Sunday, and you get up, and you out yourself in front of your own people. And then you trust God for the outcomes. I can't do that. I said, well then, it'll happen anyway. And you'll lose everything. Let me say to you, beloved, take courage. If you are in any way involved in, connected to, a situation that does not allow you to have the integrity and the ability to be fully who you are, stop paying for your own abuse. That's a psychosis. Stop paying your tithe. Stop giving your offerings.
Say, Bishop.
Stop supporting environments that do not support you.
My God.
And even if it means we have to start some small things.
Go ahead.
Just like Richard Allen did when he left the Methodist Church.
Come on, Bishop.
The AME Church was born out of a revolt.
That's right.
And it started as a small thing. Sometimes we have to start a small thing and grow that small thing until it really reflects all of our abilities, our gifts, our passions, and our skills. But stop paying for your own abuse. Stop supporting. Stop keeping silent for someone else to continue to abuse. A generation after you and after them and after them and after them. I deputize you today and hold you responsible.
Come on.
To stop holding up negative environments, no matter where it is, no matter who it is, and cease to acclimate yourself. Stop being three or four or five or six people, somebody this weekend that's going to go over here and speak, Dave. Listen to what I'm saying. And then show back up in somebody else's pulpit who doesn't know anything else about this. And think that our full selves are not at some point going to catch up with us.
Come on now.
It is the breeding ground for why we have solutions and ways in which we can live and relegate HIV to a chronic and manageable disease.
Yes.
Why is it still our problem? It is still our problem because we are still wrestling with shame. Oh, come on.
Come on.
you to know who you are today.
Go ahead, Bishop.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
You are priests and kings.
Go ahead, Bishop.
Yeah.
Come on.
You are the ones, when Israel tells its story, they say that there were a group of people who were called out to be priests and kings. They were not given to war. They didn't take up a sword.
That's right.
They were called the priests and kings of the house of God. They were the sons of Judah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They were the ones who were skillful on the instruments.
Awesome. Yeah.
They were the ones who sang the songs. They were the praise leaders.
Yeah.
They were the praise warriors. And they were so special that they were called the priesthood. They didn't even have to buy their own food. The people brought the sacrifices. And they brought them to them. And they lived for and in the house of God. And so great was their power.
Come on, my Lord.
That often when the armies went to war, if the children of Judah got on the front of the battle and they sang songs, the power of God, oh, I'm feeling Pentecostal. The power of God would fall such that the army would never have to fight. And when I read the story about the sons of Judah and the sons of Issachar, the sons of Issachar also never took up swords.
Yes.
That, somebody know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
They were called the people who knew the season.
Yes, the season.
And the times. Who were these people? They were the prophets and the musicians.
Yes.
Look at somebody, say the prophets, and the musicians. The prophets and the musicians. And I looked at somebody and said they was gay. Oh, you don't believe me. Because overrepresented in this community are the seers and the artists. The seers, some of you have been able to see and perceive from the time that you were a child. And somebody repressed that thing in you. And you can still see. You can still perceive. You're still prophetic. You still know. You still hear. You still receive a word from the divine.
Come on, Bishop.
Pray to share it. But I want you to break out. I'm giving you permission today. Bust out of it.
Yes.
Get out of your tomb. Kick your own gravestone off yourself. If you can be great on your day job, I challenge you to be great for your God.
Yes.
If you can be great when you're where you make your money, I challenge you to be great for your God. And do not allow the perceptions of organized religion to diminish the greatness that is in you. Fish do not drown in water, and birds do not fall to their death from the sky, because they are living in the place that they are acclimated to be in. If you are forced into an environment, either by your sense of self-loathing or low self-esteem, or by those who stand over your life to make you feel that you cannot exist without them, I declare to you today, break out and be in a place where you will not be diminished. And if we have to start small, brothers, sons, then let's start small and make happen the environment that the generations following us will appreciate us for.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.